Hi. Today, we're going to be studying Donna Lee, which is a composition by Miles Davis. It's often wrongly attributed to Charlie Parker. And it's based on the chord changes of Back Home Again in Indiana, an old standard. It was a fight song for the football team. And what we're going to study with this is the elements contained in it. You know, there are, just as our bodies are made up of things, elements. It has a chemical compounds. There are chemical compounds that make us up. A good meal has different spices. So does music. There's a reason that it sounds good. And Donna Lee has everything that makes it delicious. There are scales, there are arpeggios, there are permutations, in other words, broken up scales and arpeggios. Those are diatonic things. There are a nice use of thirds and sevenths, what Miles Davis called the butter notes. There are the chromatics, which are neighbor notes and passing tones. It's all there. In fact, Joe DiOrio, who was one of the great guitarists, is one of the great guitarists and was an early mentor of mine, once said that one of the best lessons he could give me would be to tell me to go home and learn Donna Lee in 12 keys. Because it would certainly develop your facility, but to learn it with understanding is another thing, when you really understand what's going on in it. So for this reason, we're going to take it apart phrase by phrase and understand what the elements are that make up Donna Lee. And this is a very important aspect of things. So the step number one is just listen to it a lot. And and sing along with it. You know, you can sing the solos afterwards, but just try to sing the head. So the head is coming up. Here we go. So we sing along with it. You might sing along while you feel the pocket. So we talk about the pocket being on 2 and 4, for example. Then you might sing it without the record and try to snap your pocket on 2 and 4. So it doesn't matter if you get the right notes. You might later want to slow it down and try to sing all the right notes. You might also try to feel it with the halftime pocket. So let's say I'll play the record and I'll be feeling instead of 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. As I explained in a different tutorial, that is the 3 of the 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. But somehow it doesn't swing as much as if I think of it going in half. So if I'm going 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4. So you might sing it that way with the halftime pocket. I'll sing now along with the record. We'll put it back to the beginning. And So there we have it, where I kind of messed up at the beginning. Hard to sync with the tape and play, you know, push the buttons at the same time. But that's the idea. So go through the whole song and listen to Bird solo too, Miles solo and Bud Powell solo, and see if you can keep the pocket of the halftime going, and then keep the pocket of the regular, what I call the regular pocket, and I call the deep pocket. The deep pocket is the halftime, the long meter, they used to call it, long meter. And the other one is the what, 2 and 4, so. Etc. And then the deeper pocket, 1, 2, 3, you know. Etc. Now you might also do this exercise. We'll call it step one, is understanding the rhythms of Donna Lee. You might do 4 bars or 8 bars of each. So you go 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. There, I did, you know, 8, and you could even do 4 of each. So that would be our first exploration of Donna Lee. Now, let's analyze the phrasing of Donna Lee. So we'll go phrase by phrase and understand what elements are used in this melody and how they relate to the harmony. So let's take the first phrase is. So our changes being, I'll speak concert, the A flat into the C minor F7th, or the F7th really. We go down and we play the F7th, and then that hits the B-flat dominant 7th. So it's 1 to 6 dominant to 2 dominant 7th. So 2-7, as we call it. And that's our first cadence. Well, we cadence when we go home, but that's the beginning of our first cadence. So that's what we do, is we're playing using diatonic notes with one neighbor. And then we're going down the A flat major scale from the 5th until we hit the A natural, which is the butter note, the 3rd of the F7th. And then we use a diminished chord. We use a diminished arpeggio with one little neighbor note beneath the 5th of that. So we have. So that's our diminished chord, and that goes into another arpeggio, which is the 3rd to the 9th of the B-flat 7th, then dipping down a 4th from the 9th to the 13th to the 5th. So this is. So So scale, da da ba da ba da da, arpeggio, ba 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 with one neighbor note, scale with one neighbor, ba 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 arpeggio, third to the ninth, ba ba b, down to the 13th, da da. So that's our first phrase. Now, when you're learning these things, you might take little fragments of them and learn them in other keys. When you have something like ba ba bo be dee bop, oh, that's good to know in every key because you have the third. A half diminished arpeggio is the same as a dominant ninth chord from the third to the ninth. In other words, D half diminished is equal to B flat seventh without the root, or B flat ninth with no root. And if you drop down a fourth from the ninth, you get the 13th of the chord. So this is a good thing to know. So then you might practice that chromatically in the cycle of fifths and just play the phrase. You might do something like that. And I'm just playing it in a few of the keys, but I would play it all over the horn. And I would also play, say I'm starting on the major seventh of the key, play one neighbor note, heading into the third of the sixth dominant, and then using the diminished chord that begins on the fifth of the sixth dominant chord, with one little neighbor note in that, and then that puts me into two, or two, 2-7, or two minor seven, or it could also lead me to one, if I were going to, you know, if F seventh were leading me to B flat major, I could also use that. So I might go. And using that major third as just a resolution point. And then I say, well, what if I were a fourth away? Let me see, if I were in the key of D flat, then I would start on the major seventh. I would come down the scale with that one little neighbor note, which is the third note. And that would bring me to my third of the sixth chord in D flat, which is my B flat seventh. And then I would go up that B flat seventh from the third to the ninth, B flat ninth. So that would be. And then I have the diminished chord from the third of the key. So I have to think about it slowly. You know, I say, okay, I start on the major seventh of the key of E. And then there's my neighbor note. Now, down the key further. Then I'm hitting my diminished thing. Down the scale, then into my half diminished chord, which is the minor, which is the third to the ninth of the dominant. Drop down a fourth, get my 13th. One more time. I'm getting it in all the keys. I'm understanding where I'm going with it. I might even do even more, make it more incremental. I might start with the first four notes and say that if I start on the major seventh of the key and then put one neighbor note down from the major seventh to the fifth, boo-you-doo-dop, boo-you-da-dop. And then as a little exercise with myself, I go say I want to do that in an intervallic combination. I might do it up and down in half steps. I might do it in the cycle of fifths. I might say to myself, well, let me just try those four notes and see if I can play those in minor thirds. So I'll go. Okay, that's my key of A, that's the key of A flat concert. So a minor third up would be B concert. And a minor third up from that is D concert. And then we have F concert. There it is. Tonic it each time so I hear it. I might start that from another couple of places away. From the other minor third possibilities. So right away, I've gotten one, two, at least three exercises out of the first four bars of Donna Lee. So that's what I mean. You two take it, and in those first four bars, I've got all these ideas out of it and things to practice in all the keys. So then, let's say, so we have analyzing it. We've got do-do-da-dee-do-do-da-da. So that's down to the diminished chord that's involved with our sixth chord, with that one neighbor note, da ba da di da ba, arpeggio ba ba do bi da ba. Now, what's our next phrase? Okay, so that is an upper chromatic and lower chromatic neighbor note to the fifth of the key, which is the 11th of the minor seventh, the two minor seventh chord, which is our B flat minor seventh. And then the lower neighbor to the root, and then all the way up the chord to. All the way root, third, fifth, seventh, ninth, 11th, third. And then we have the arpeggio, which is from the upper part of the minor seventh chord, bo 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 be da ba ba be, which is the minor triad beginning on the fifth of the two chord. So that's always the minor triad a fifth away. So that's a D minor triad, which is really the fifth, seventh, and ninth of the two chord. So we played our two chord with neighbor notes, then a neighbor, and all the way arpeggiating the chord all the way up to the 11th, and then down a whole step to the third. So, you know, you could also play there in all the keys. There we have again the other one. We're heading into the 11th, so. And then, the same idea. Let's say, if I'm going to do it in maybe on F minor. And you just play it phrase by phrase through the keys. And then Our next change is we go up the, as I said, in the triad that's built on the fifth of the two chord, which is a minor triad, a fifth away. And that would be, in this case, our F minor. And there's our use of an upper structure. And so we go up the triad. Ba bo be da ba ba ah. Oh, sorry. Ba bo be e ah ba e ah ba. So there, that leads us into the E flat seventh concert, and that would be, some people would say, your sharp fifth, but I like to think of it as your flat 13. So that's an upper structure melody. It also could be thought of as being on the subdominant minor, is another way to think of it, however you want to think of it. You could think of it as 7-3-2-1 of the minor seventh, the minor chord, a minor third above the B flat minor concert of D flat minor, as the E flat seventh chord, where you have the flat 13 to the flat 9 to the root to the 7th. So, you know, and then right up the one chord, the one major 7th from the 3rd to the 9th. So that's another phrase. It's a little more complicated, but to hear the resolution of that, you might spend all day on one of these phrases from this. I'm not saying you get them in a day, but I say, oh, now that's a little more complex. I have the third, and then the ninth, and then I have the ninth moves down a half step and becomes the flat 13. The flat 13 goes down a fifth to the flat 9 to the root to the 7th, and then resolves into my third. So now if I want to take that and put that a fourth away, a fifth away, if I was going to play that on C minor 7th, I'm sorry, on E flat minor, A flat 7th, I say to myself, well, I hit the third, and then I hit that arpeggio, then I have another arpeggio that that starts on the fifth, 7th, and 9th, the minor chord of fifth away, as I said, of the two chord. So if I'm talking about E flat minor concert, I got the E flat minor, and I have the B flat minor. So I have. And then. So there, I would actually think of it as being the minor third above is easier for me. So if I think of it as being in this key, I'm hitting my arpeggio of the E flat minor, and then I'm thinking of it as an F sharp minor, being, even though that gives me that upper structure, it's more related to the E flat seventh, but nevertheless, easier for me to think, for always find the easy way, just a minor third above, then I'm hitting the seventh, the third, the ninth, and the root. So. Let's say I was doing that let's say I put that in B flat concert. So I would have to think of it being so I would come in from the half step down So there I went right up to C minor from the lower neighbor. And then I would go to the G minor, which is the fifth triad built on the fifth. And then I'm thinking now of the E flat minor. So if I was playing the neighbor notes to my 11th or my fourth of the scale, the Dorian scale, now up the chord, now the chord that's built on the fifth, now a minor third above the 7 to the 3-2-1, now up the B flat major from the third. So, you know, that's our, I'll play the last phrase and we'll analyze that, and then that will be our first 8 bars of Donna Lee. I'll continue the rest of it in tutorial number 2. But here's our beginning of analyzing Donna Lee. We sing it, play it with the pockets, and here is the last phrase of the first 8 bars. We're now moving up a fourth. The one is turning into a dominant or a 2-5 up to 4. And the way we're getting there is we're using diatonic scale notes and then arpeggio notes. The third of the 2 chord up to the 9th. And then we have these 2 notes, which I call an isolated upper structure. Basically, the E concert is the flat 13 of the A flat 7th. Some people think of it as the sharp 5, but I just hear it as that. And it drops down a major third. It's into the third. And then it likes to resolve to the 9th. That's there. Now we're on bar 9, and it will continue, and we'll continue this in the next tutorial. But for instance, just this movement of the, let's say, the flat 13 to the third of the dominant, resolving to the 9th of the 1, is a very important movement. You hear it all through bebop. It's like, you know, so there it's a harmonic line of the 9 of the 2 moving down to the flat 13 and then moving to the 9th of the 1. So ba da da. So you might go play that phrase in all the keys. Up the chord, ba ba do ba da bu da. Or just those 3 notes. The flat 13 to the 3rd, resolve to the 9th. Perhaps in the cycle of fifths. And you sit at the piano and you just hear those 3 notes and how they work and how they go all through the cycles. Do them in half steps, do them different ways on different days. Anyway, this has been a moment with Mover. I'd like to also tell you that the mouthpiece I'm playing on this right now is the Ted Klum YARDBIRD mouthpiece, which is modeled on the last mouthpiece that Charlie Parker played through the last 4 or 5 years of his career, made for him in England by the Selmer Company. Ted has basically gotten the inside scoop on how that mouthpiece is constructed. And it's a beautiful mouthpiece. I really suggest it and recommend it. That would be it for now. I'll be back very soon with the next 8 bars of Donna Lee. Hope you've enjoyed it. This is presented by the Bob Mover Academy. We're open for private lessons already, but we've got some wonderful classes. And if you like this, if you're somewhere where you can do it, please like it and subscribe. Thank you.